Millions of Jews from around the world gathered to celebrate Passover in Jerusalem. Among them were Jesus of Nazareth and his disciples.
This religion, which we call Christianity today, began as a part of Judaism. What is unique about Christianity among the Jewish groups is that they had their messianic expectation focused on a single person, Jesus.
They expected a coronation. What they saw was an act of redemption.
So he was going to do something of eternal significance as the Lamb of God who took away the sins of the world.
Five days before Passover, the lambs were brought to Jerusalem to be chosen for sacrifice. On the same day, Jesus entered the city for the last time before his death.
All going back to the sacrifice ritual, going back to the Passover lamb, saying this is the ultimate substitute. The one who's coming is not coming the way you're expecting.
The prophet Zechariah had announced his arrival 500 years earlier. Behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and riding on a donkey.
The donkey is a symbol from Zechariah, not of political power, but of a Messiah who comes meek and lowly, and not as a Messiah who comes with a sword in the hand to overthrow the Romans.
When Jesus arrived in the city, people shouted the words of King David, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. During the feast, millions of Jews gathered to worship in the temple. First, they stopped to wash in the pool of Siloam. And here, they saw firsthand the fulfillment of Isaiah's prophecy about the Messiah. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened. It was here that Jesus healed a blind man by putting mud on his eyes.
Why would he send him to this pool to wash his eyes?
This was considered to be the pool and the water of the highest purity because the waters in this pool issue out from underneath the temple itself. And so he wanted to make sure this guy got the best. And you see, the blind can't see if they touch something that makes them unclean, so they can't go up into the temple. All they would have to do is go down, immerse themselves, let them present themselves to the priest. Then they'd be able to go into the temple the first time in their whole life. And this is what was going to happen with this man who was born blind.
He could now go into the temple. It's one of the greatest statements of, I have a fact that supersedes your law and reasoning. Once I was blind, but now I see.
This street runs along the western wall of the Temple Mount. In Jesus' day, these booths were filled with merchants and money changers. Some say it's the place where he fulfilled yet another prophecy.
Malachi the prophet said the Lord himself would come to the second temple. There would be a divine visitation and God would come and purify and cleanse the religious system. Jesus, the divine Messiah, visits the temple. He fulfills what had to happen before the second temple was destroyed.
Jesus overturned the tables of the money changers, speaking the words of the prophets, Isaiah and Jeremiah. My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves.
If we rightly understand the Hebrew Bible, either Jesus is our Messiah or there can never be a Messiah. The Messianic era had to begin before the second temple was destroyed. Otherwise, there can be no redemption.
Jesus himself predicted the destruction of the temple. Not one stone shall be left upon another that shall not be thrown down. The chief priests saw Jesus' words as a threat. From then on, they planned to kill him, and they got help from one of his disciples.
We will never know what was going on in the mind of Judas Iscariot. We do know that in the minds of Jesus' followers, this was a great betrayal.
On the night before Passover, Jesus and his disciples gathered one last time to celebrate the Seder.
At the Last Supper, we understand that Jesus is preparing the disciples for the trauma that is about to unfold. He says, now let me tell you what it means to be the Messiah. I'm going to be arrested. I'm going to be mocked and beaten, and I'm going to be put to death. and on the third day I will rise again.
During the meal, Jesus handed Judas a piece of bread, identifying the one who would betray him, a signal David had prophesied in the Psalms. My own familiar friend, who ate my bread, has lifted up his heel against me. The chief priests paid Judas 30 pieces of silver to hand over Jesus, the price of a common slave. Overcome by guilt, Judas later tried to give back the money. The priests refused, so Judas threw the silver on the floor of the temple, then went out and killed himself. With the blood money, they bought this potter's field. Tradition says this is where Judas hanged himself, and today it's still known as the Field of Blood. 500 years earlier, Zechariah had predicted the price on Jesus' head, as well as the act of Judas, throwing the money into the house of the Lord to the potter. While Judas carried out his betrayal, the rest of the disciples finished the Passover meal. They sang a hymn called the Great Praise, or Hallel in Hebrew. The words written by King David 1,000 years earlier took on new meaning as Jesus headed closer to the cross. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. This is the psalm that Jesus sang after he lifted up the cup of the new covenant in his blood. I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Then they sang the same words the crowds had shouted a few days earlier when Jesus entered Jerusalem. Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.